See, good afternoon all. Even though instead of repeating instructions again, the strength of the participants are very poor. Okay, so per week I will have 5 classes. Out of those 5 classes, one class is at 9 o'clock and another 2 classes starts at 10 o'clock. And unfortunately, the remaining 2 classes are at this particular time, 12 o'clock. I know this will create some interruptions, but nothing is in my hand. Obviously, I told you several times regarding the attendance. Still, if your attendance is like this, definitely authorities will take action. Okay. So at that time, you don't have any chance to ask them excuses. I don't know why you people are absent. So many people. See, just only 25 participants are there. 25. It's so embarrassing. See, I don't know how much busy you are. See, as a student, I think you don't have any works at home. Even though if you're having any works, so you please engage them in the afternoon sessions. See why? Because afternoon sessions are completely free. I think so. If you are not willing to attend the classes, obviously you can write a letter to your counselor so that you please pass that letter to your counselor. So the reason why you are not going to attend the classes, and later that will be processed to our HOD as well as principal sir. But this is ridiculous. So many people are thinking in that way, that anyway attendance will be provided, but that is not correct. If your situation is like this, obviously we will take an action. Definitely we will take an action. We won't give you the attendance also. I told you several times that the proof is completely the online session. See, from the Zoom itself, we are getting the your login time, logout time, and also the attendance details of the each and every candidate from beginning of the semester to the ending of the semester. So definitely you will face that if we will take those details from this Zoom account. Obviously, there's a lot of problems arises. Okay, maybe this may affect your future. Fee reimbursement scheme. Okay, so everything is in your hand. I don't know why you are taking very light about this, but anyway, today we are going to discuss about the last case in the Gauss-Seidel method of load flow solution, right? So for that purpose, I have solved the problem for your sake. Just I am going to show you. So instead of wasting the time, just you please go through these steps what I have solved for you people, right? Now for that purpose, I'm going to share my screen here. I'm sharing the PowerPoint presentation of the problem. Right. Now you see, so in the last class and before the last class, day before yesterday also, we have seen the problems which we are doing for calculating the bus voltages, real power and reactive powers by considering different cases. Okay, now in the text, see the same aspect, this is also in the same aspect, this is also very important problem. Definitely you may get some chances of getting this type of problems, right? Now you see here, a 3-bus system is as shown in the figure. Just wait a moment. I will zoom out this so that you will be able to identify it. Right. The 3-bus system is as shown in the figure, and per unit line admittances are on 100 MVA base are indicated. Form Y bus and determine the voltage at bus number 2 and bus number 3 after the second Gauss iteration and take alpha is equal to 1.6. Clearly, the problem in the problem, he has mentioned each and every point. So initially, you have been given a three bus system, and in that three bus system the line admittances have been mentioned. See, I told you this, whenever he has given the admittances, definitely he must mention that point in the problem itself. At the beginning of the problem, I told you this point. Okay, now see this problem. In this particular case, now this is the three bus system. So first bus number one and bus number two, you will have a generators, and at bus number three, you will have a load. Just you forget about that. And obviously you will have three admittances, minus J3, minus J4, minus J5. And the information regarding the values are mentioned in the problem itself. Now you see here, per unit line admittances are on 100 MVA base are indicated. So those are per unit values. Now you are asked to form Y-bus. Okay, and also determine the voltage at bus number 2 and bus number 3 at the end of second gauss iteration, right? And you need to consider an accelerating factor of 1.6. So yesterday's class we have discussed about the acceleration factors. Just to reduce the number of iterations and to save some memory, see, basically this gauss seidel method is a computer programming method. So whenever we are using computer programming methods, obviously we require some space for storing all the elements. If the number of iterations has been increased, means obviously the storage has been reduced. Okay, so for reducing the number of iterations and to have the proper convergence, we are accelerating. That means we are going to change the bus voltages. So that's why we are using accelerating factors, and that accelerating factor is denoted with the alpha is equal to 1.6. Okay, now you are asked to consider alpha is equal to 1.6 here, right? Now the bus data has been mentioned. You please see the bus data, bus number 1, bus number 2, bus number 3. So bus number 1 is a slack bus, bus number 2 and bus number 3 are of PQ buses. So generation, demand and bus voltages at all the buses have been mentioned. Now if you consider the generation, there the real power generation is indicated in megawatts. Reactive power is indicated in terms of MVAR. Similarly, the demand power is also indicated in terms of megawatts, and QD is nothing but the reactive power of the demand is indicated in terms of MVAR. Similarly, the bus voltage and the phase angle have been mentioned, and already we know that. See, in this particular case, particular problem, we are having only two types of buses. The first one is slack bus, second one is PQ bus. So what are the specified parameters of the slack bus? Voltage and phase angle are specified, and you are asked to determine the real power and the reactive power. See, obviously the demand at the slack bus is equal to zero. That's what he has already given. So you need not determine the demand powers, demand real power and demand reactive power. And the only thing is you need to obtain what is the generated power and what is the reactive power of the bus number 1. That is nothing but the slack bus. And for the two remaining buses, that means those two are PQ buses, and the generation in terms of megawatts and MVAR has been mentioned. Demand is also mentioned, and similarly the question mark is there. That means you are indirectly asked to determine what is the voltage and phase angle of the second bus and third bus at the end of gauss seidel method. That means, so that has been clearly mentioned in the problem itself, right? So that's why I told you the importance of the problems, in particularly while we are discussing about the gauss seidel method. Once if you are familiar with all these calculations, obviously it's very, very easy to understand and easy to attempt those questions in your university question papers also. That is very, very important. Now, what is the first thing you are asked to determine? So that is, the first one is Y-bus formation. So you consider this one. This is a given system. This is the given system. Now, excuse me. Now, so already you people are familiar with the direct inspection method of forming Y-bus. So according to the direct inspection, so directly we can write down this Y-bus. So Y-bus is equal to let us verify whether these are correct or not. Okay, right? So Y11, that is nothing but a self admittance. So you need to add all the admittances which have been connected to bus number one without any sign change. Obviously, there are two admittances. One is minus J3 and another one is minus J4. So if you add those two, obviously you will get minus J7. Y bus. Next, Y12. So Y12 is minus J3. So minus of minus J3, you will get J3. Next, Y13. So Y13 is obviously equal to J4. Okay, so minus J7, J3, J4, right? Now, what is Y21? Again, Y21 is equal to Y12. So J3, and similarly, Y22, second bus. If you take the second bus, there are again two admittances, minus J3 and minus J5. So obviously, you will get minus J8. Next one is J5. Please make a note. Okay. And next one is, so J4, Y13 is equal to Y31. So similarly, it is J5. So minus J9. So first you take down this one. You take down all this. So this is about the Y bus, formation of Y bus. So after getting Y bus, 1/4 of the problem has been completed. So you can have some confidence. Right? Now the next thing is very, very important. So till now, we have solved the problems in this Gauss-Seidel method of iteration by considering the per unit values of the real power and reactive power. But as far as the given bus data is concerned, in that bus data, in the table, he has given the real values. That means the actual values, not per unit values. So how can you say that those values are actual values? Why? Because if you see that the table, generation, PG is expressed in terms of megawatts, QG is expressed in terms of MVAR. Similarly, in the case of demand also, PD is expressed in terms of megawatts, QD is expressed in terms of MVAR. So just by looking at those values, obviously you can say that those values are actual values, not the per unit values. So how can we obtain the per, or how can you change those values to per unit values? That's why in the problem, he has mentioned one line. So you have to consider all the values on a base value of 100 MVA. Okay. So according to the definition of per unit value is equal to actual value by base value. That is very, very clear. And you people are familiar with that one also, right? Now, simply the PI, the real power loss, is equal to the difference between generation power and the demand power. And the reactive power loss at ith bus is given by QGI minus QDI. We already know that. Consider 100 MVA base of the entire system. So now we are going to convert all the actual values to the per unit value. So P2 is equal to, so PG2 minus PD2. So PG2 is 25, PD2 is 50. So 25 minus 50 is minus 25 megawatts. So if we want to express this minus 25 megawatts to per units, obviously you can divide this actual value by the base value. So base value is equal to 100. So minus 25 by 100, you will get minus 0.25 per unit. So similarly, you can also obtain Q2 and P3 and Q3. All these are very, very simple. So the first and foremost important point remember here is you need to convert the actual values to per unit values. Okay, you need to express all those values by considering proper base value of 100 MVA. Now we are going to start the calculations. Okay, the first Gauss iteration. So how can see already we already know that. So in this particular PDF, I do not want to solve again by substitute, but this is not the acceptable. Okay, so here just go through this. Here directly I am writing V21 is equal to 0.995 minus J 0.0312, that is equal to 0.9954 at an angle of minus 1.798. But while doing this problem in your university or internal or it may be external examinations, you need to elaborate. First of all, you have to write down, we know that VI is equal to 1 by YII. Already you know this formula very well. So first of all, you have to write down all these things. So we know that VI is equal to 1 by YII minus P minus JQI divided by VI conjugate, okay, minus K is equal to 1 to N and which should not be equal to I, etc. YIK into VK. So first of all, you have to write down this formula. Later, you can substitute the values of YII, PI and QI, YIK, VK values. And after simplifying that expression, you will get this one. So you need to extend, you need to elaborate your answer. Okay. So this is only for your understanding. I am writing V21. So this is your final answer. But how can you get this answer? Just by simply substituting the values of YII, PII, KQI and YAK, VK and you will get this one. Okay. So in this way, already you know how to obtain this V21. Why? Because in the previous class and before that class, we have already solved some problems to obtain the ith bus voltage at the end of first Gauss iteration, right? But in this case, what is the difference between this problem and the earlier problems we have discussed? In this case, you are asked to consider the accelerated value of the second bus voltage. So how can we obtain the accelerated value of the voltage? Already we have seen the formula. So VI to the power of R plus 1 accelerated value is equal to, see yesterday we have seen this. So VI to the power of R plus alpha into VA to the power of R plus 1 minus VA to the power of R. Okay, so this is the formula that we are going to use for obtaining the accelerated value. Okay, so after getting the first the second bus voltage at the end of first Gauss iteration, consider the accelerated value. And now we are going to obtain the accelerated value of the second bus voltage. Now you see here, how can we obtain the accelerated value of the second bus voltage? So V21 accelerated is equal to V20 plus alpha into V21 minus V20. So V20 directly he has given our formula. First of all, you need to consider the flat voltage start. So according to that flat voltage start, V20 is equal to V30 is equal to 1 at an angle 0. That already we know. But V21 just now we have obtained that as 0.99554 at an angle of minus 1.798. Okay. Is it clear? Okay. Now if you simply substitute V20 is equal to, so let us do this one. 1 at an angle 0 plus alpha, that is 1.6 multiplied by what is V2 dash? So 0.9954 at an angle of minus 1.798 minus 1 at an angle 0. Now, if you simplify this, obviously in polar form, you will get 0.9924 at an angle of minus 2.884. And in rectangular form, you will get 0.992 minus j, 0.049. So this is the accelerated value of the second burst at the end of first gas iteration. So likewise, now we are going to see the third burst voltage at the end of first gas iteration. And after that, we are going to accelerate that burst voltage also, right? Now you see here. Now this one. Now you see here. So here also V3 dash. Just wait a moment. I will tell you one important point while doing this one, right? Just you go through this. So V3 dash is equal to 1 by Y33. P3 minus JQ3 divided by V30 conjugate minus, now carefully observe this, YIK. So Y31 V10. This already we know, not V10, V1 minus Y32. Now this is not only V21, this is V21 accelerated. So please try to understand or observe the difference, clear difference. So whenever we are going to calculate the third bus voltage, you have to use the second bus voltage. So for which voltage you need to consider, so that two accelerated value of the second bus voltage you need to consider for calculating V31. Understand? Okay. So after calculating V3 dash by using V21 accelerated value, you will get 0.9752 at an angle of minus 5.55 degrees, and which is also equal to 0.9706 minus J0.0944. You please take down those answers. At least you take down those answers. Later you will do your own calculations, but at least you please try to note down those answers. These will be helpful. Okay, please note down those answers. Similarly, the second Gauss iteration, please note down this also. Second Gauss iteration, see, you just note down the formula and you take down those values. Later, you will do all these problems at your home. Don't worry. Just you take down those answers. Now, today we are going to wind up this Gauss Seidel method. So later, we are going to have the flow chart and algorithm also. We shall discuss those points today. Please note down as early as possible. Just you take down those answers. Okay, got it. So now the only thing that is left is you are asked to, okay, you are asked to find out the slack bus power also. Please do remember that. So in the bus data, he has already given a question mark. That means indirectly you are asked to determine P1 and Q1 also. So for that purpose, now I'm going to calculate the slack bus power. So as we all know that the complex power at the ith bus is given by Vi conjugate multiplied by Ii, which is equals to Pi minus jQi. Okay, now I'm going to consider that I is equal to 1. Why? Because the first bus is the slack bus. So S1 is equal to V1 conjugate multiplied by I1. Now V1 conjugate multiplied by Y11 into V1, Y12 into V2, Y13 into V3. Now, a very important point you need to remember at this particular stage is what are the values that you are going to consider for V1, V2, V3. So V1 is already given 1.02 at an angle of 0. V2 is nothing but V22 accelerated value. Why? Because already he has mentioned in the problem itself, you are asked to consider V22 accelerated and V32 accelerated values. So just by substituting those values, you can get P1 minus JQ1 is equal to 1.1786 minus J0.6136. So obviously we have P1 is equal to 1.178 per unit and Q1 is equal to 0.6136 per unit. So if you want to have the actual values, why? Because in the table, he has mentioned the actual value. So that's why if you multiply that per unit value with the base value, obviously you can get the actual value, that is in terms of megawatts and MVAR. So finally, P1 is equal to 117.8 and Q1 is equal to 61.36 MVAR. Right? Noted? Right. So with this, I'm going to wind up. The problems related to the Gauss Seidel method of load flow solution. Now I'm going to share another PDF document that contains algorithm and flowchart. That just I will show you, and I will try to explain. But you please make sure that if you are just wait a minute. So I think this is also clear, right? So the procedure for load flow solution by Gauss Seidel method. Each and every step already we have seen practically while doing or while deriving the static load flow equations or while deriving the ith bus voltage using static load flow equations or while doing the problems. Okay. So in all these cases, we have seen this process, but he has written in terms of words. That is the only difference between the algorithm and the flowchart. So now see here, assume flat voltage start. Already we have seen that. So accept the slack bus voltage, you need to assume all the bus voltages. We know that, right? Now assume a sortable value of convergence criterion, specified change already. We have seen that one also. Why? Because Vi to the power of r plus 1 minus Vi to the power of r should be less than or equal to the epsilon. Epsilon is nothing but the convergence. So that should be equal to 0.001. Every time you are going to determine the difference between the two successive iterations, iteration voltages, then obviously you can able to identify which one is correct, right? Now the set iteration count k is equal to, so obviously basically this is a computer programming method. So every time we must start with the iteration count that is equal to zero. Set bus count is equal to, so bus number. So obviously if you are having three buses or four buses, later first of all you need to define bus number one, or you need to start with the bus number one. Okay. Now you see here the reactive power. Yesterday we have seen this one also. That means conversion of PQ bus to PV bus. Suddenly, if PQ bus has been transferred to the PV bus, obviously you can able to calculate the reactive power at the same time the phase angle. So this is how you are going to use that one. So you need not write a line by line or point by point. You just remember how to proceed to the next step. Okay, so please try to follow the textbook or the material, whichever is convenient to you. I am not going to say that you mug up and you just by heart all those steps what he has written and you are going to produce the same. I'm not going to say that. That is not correct also. First of all, you have to analyze and you have to understand which step is the next one. Okay, so step number 7 is to calculate the reactive power. Okay, with the use of this one. So just yesterday we have seen this one also. If the reactive power limits are violated, so what happens if the reactive power limits are violated? So if the calculated value of reactive power is less than the minimum value of the QI minimum, obviously you can set QP is equal to QP minimum. Suppose if the calculated value is above the maximum value, obviously you can set the QP calculated value is equal to maximum, right? Next, so how can you calculate ith bus voltage and the phase angle? Already we have seen directly while deriving the static ith bus voltage using static load flow equations. Already we have seen this one also, right? So nothing is new to you. Already you know all these things. Acceleration factor, step number 10, already we have taken that acceleration factor just now only. And you need to obtain the difference between the successive iterations. If the difference is equal to epsilon, obviously you can say that that is the final fixed voltage. Right? Now this is the flow chart. See, don't worry. I will forward this material to you. Don't worry about that. Just only for your reference, I am showing these contents to you. So whatever may be the contents, just we have written, and those are directly represented like this. in the form of flowchart. So with this, we are going to wind up this Gauss Seidel method of load flow solution, which is a very, very easiest, I think so. In my point of view, this is very easy. But whenever you do some practice, obviously this may becomes very easy to you also. Okay, don't worry about too much. The very important point is don't worry about too much, and don't feel that this is very difficult. So in my point of view, students may feel that. Just wait a moment. Okay, so just wait a moment. See, the Gauss Seidel method of load flow solution is very, very important. At the same time, it is also very easiest method. So most of the times the students may feel that this is very difficult. But as far as my knowledge is concerned, I have dealt with this subject for three to four times. So as far as my knowledge is concerned, this is very easy, right? So this is very easy, but the only thing is there are two very important questions. Those are: explain Gauss Seidel method of load flow solutions. Explain Gauss Seidel method of load flow solution with the use of algorithm and flowchart. That is a very important theory question. Suppose if you are, if we want to give you a theory question, that is very important. The second one is explain NR method of load flow solution. Explain NR method of load flow solution with the use of flowchart. With the use of flowchart and algorithm. Right? So please make sure that these two load flow solution techniques are very, very important, and at the same time very easy also. The only thing is don't by heart. You just simply go through the steps what I have discussed in the classroom. Right, so that's all for today. If you are having any doubts, you please raise your doubts. That's the end of the session, and tomorrow we shall start with the new thing, that is NR method, right? Thank you.